videos created here now. There's one that's still rendering in YouTube or uploading in YouTube. And then this is the last video that I'll need to create as I'm going through this. So I want to sort of give you an overview. So this would be the video that you would be watching second. So you would have started off with this video data collection methods overview, then you would have looked at this link on methods of data collection, and then looked at this link, an overview of quantitative and qualitative data collection methods, and then you would have this new video that I'm creating will actually be right here before you get to the video on assessments and surveys. And basically what I want to do here now is just sort of give you an overview on what you want to do moving forward. So now that you've had a little bit of an introduction between these and the textbook, you know, so these three initial resources and the textbook as to the various methods of data collection that you might be interested in pursuing, what you want to do now is keep in mind a couple of things as you're selecting those. The first is that for each research question that you have, you want to have at least two methods of data collection to answer each question. Now, that doesn't mean that if you have two questions, you need four different methods. As you saw from the introductory or overview video, that I think it was the example from Jen Hill, where she had two questions. The first one used observations and the Ames 10 data and the student artifacts. The second question used student artifacts and the Ames 10 data. So while she had two questions, she only had three methods of data collection. So two of the methods were used to answer two of the questions, and then there was a third method thrown in there for one of the individual questions. So one of the things you want to decide now, as you've gotten a little bit of an overview of each of these, is what kind of data do you want to collect to answer each of your questions? Because what you're going to have to produce for me between now and Monday, and this is what I would like by Monday, so that way you can start to explore it, is essentially I want this introductory thing. So again, you know, this is another example here. This is one from Allison Wills. She did a case study of teacher leadership at elementary schools. Slightly different in terms of her formatting compared to the other two that we looked at. The other two, you'll note, they restated their purpose first. You know, Allison doesn't do that. Allison starts off by saying she's using a mixed methods design where she's using surveys and interviews. And she says, you know, look at table one below, and then to understand the characteristics and beliefs of teachers in the school, she's using a survey. You know, to get, you know, she looks essentially, each of these sentences is tied to one of her research questions. So instead of giving you a you know, that brief introduction like the others did, you see Allison gives a little bit more detailed introduction before we get to the table. But when we look at the table, we still get the same thing. You know, she's got, here's her research question, she's got surveys, and here's the two different surveys. We've got a research question, here are two different methods, and then here's the survey that's going to be used. They've got another research question, surveys and interviews, and then here's the two surveys that are going to be used. So you can see for research question one, while it's one method, it's two separate surveys. So she can use each of those surveys to attempt to triangulate what she finds in one against the other. In the case of research question two, it's two items. It's this philosophy of education inventory and interviews that she's conducting. In the case of research question three, it's these two surveys, the teacher leadership survey, and the teacher leadership survey, along with researcher-developed interview questions. So surveys and interviews are her methods. For Monday, so by the end of the day on Monday, I want, however you plan on doing this introductory paragraph, and you've seen three examples of it now, and there are a couple of others that you could look at in the digital commons, and I want this table. That's all I need submitted by Monday, is this table. And once I sign off on this table, then in much the same way that you did with your methodology, where you started to go out and explore in greater detail the one methodology you selected, you're going to go and explore in greater detail the two or more methods of data collection that you've selected to be able to write, you know, the subsections that you've got here. So as you can see with Allison's, you know, here's a paragraph on how she understands, actually two paragraphs on how she understands those, you know, surveys and what kind of data she would get and why it's appropriate. And then she actually has a subsection under survey. So you see this is a level 3 heading in APA where she's got a subsection for each of the individual interviews or each of the individual surveys that she's using. So all three of the surveys that she's using are listed here, and you can see how she's using them. Then she moves on to interviews. This is what you're going to do after Monday. So once you've picked your two or more methods of data collection, then you start to spend the rest of the 2 weeks, or I guess the week and a half, looking at constructing those 2 to 4 paragraphs that you've got for each of those particular types of data collection methods. But what you need to have done by Monday is just to have that introductory paragraph and then this table completed. This is what I need. And you'll notice in Allison's case, she's got 3 columns because she doesn't just have the research question and the data collection method. She also indicates the specific instrument that she's going to use. Notice the ones that we looked at in the overview interview, or the overview video, sorry, just had 2 columns. So they just had the research questions column and data methods column. So they just had those two. How you do that is entirely up to you, but this introductory paragraph and this table are what I need from you by the end of the day on Monday. Once I sign off on the individual methods that you're using, then you want to go into Blackboard and review the video for each of those. So say you're going to use interviews as one. You would review the interviews video, and it will tell you a little bit about these resources as well as providing you with additional resources to help you construct those 2 to 4 paragraphs. You want to keep in mind as you are selecting your data collection methods, and it, you know, beyond what is there in terms of the resources that give you sort of the overview, so when you're picking them, think practicality in mind. Because again, remember, come late March, sometime in April, and throughout May likely, maybe even into June, you're going to actually have to do this. You know, so if you were doing a study and you were thinking, oh, I can answer this research question by using interviews and observations, and I'm going to interview, you know, 10 of my students for about a half hour each, and then I'm going to, you know, observe them. I'm going to take video of when I'm teaching so I can, you know, do observations of the class, and I'm going to, you know, have maybe 5 hours of class or 5 classes that I'm going to watch, so I'll have 5 hours of video. Keep in mind that, you know, those interviews need to be transcribed on the other side, you know, so you're going to have to actually go through and do a word-by-word transcription from some recording that you take of that interview. I will tell you that transcribing takes time. For most people, when they first start out transcribing, you can usually look at a 6-to-1 to 8-to-1 ratio for the amount of time it will take you to transcribe, meaning for every 1 minute of recording that you have, it'll take you about 6 to 8 minutes to actually transcribe that 1 minute. So if you've got a 30-minute interview, that essentially means it's going to take you 3 to 8 hours just to transcribe the interview itself. If you're doing 10 of your students that you're interviewing that way, you know, say you've got 3 classes and you're interviewing, well, say 9, 3 from each class. Now, all of a sudden, you know, you're looking at 3 to 4 hours of transcription times 9 or 10 students. You know, that's a fair amount of time transcribing. And then you've got to watch those videos of the observations and take field notes. And, you know, much the same way if you were to go and sit in the food court at one of the malls in, you know, in town, that if you were sort of, you know, taking field notes of the things that you saw, there's a lot of things that you're going to miss if you're just watching it once. You know, because face it, I mean, you're all classroom teachers, or you've all been classroom teachers at some point. You know, there are things that happen in your room that you don't notice. there are things that you catch out of the corner of your eye where you notice it happening at the end or you notice it at the beginning but then dismiss it because you're focused upon something else. When you're watching a video of something, the same thing's going to happen. So you're going to have to watch this multiple times. For most novice researchers, usually it's going to be 4 to 6 times. So again, for every 1 hour class that you record, if you watch it 4 to 6 times, that's 4 to 6 hours of watching each video. So even if you only recorded 4 classes, that's 16 to 24 hours of just watching video and making field notes. And that's not counting the, you know, if you pause along the way so you can write things down. Now, one of the ways in which some researchers have attempted to address some of this is they've tried to use technology as a way to mediate some of these. And there are a number of good resources out there that look at the internet and technology in general as a means of data collection that, you know, might help facilitate things. So I'll go through a bunch of general ones here and then some specific ones. So there's one here by Provenzo called The Internet and Online Research for Teachers. This one's not a bad one, although it's very general and it's kind of brief. So it's of the general ones, I wouldn't necessarily recommend it. As part of their quantitative research series, or they call it Quantitative Applications in Social Science, so it's essentially like those blue books that you'll see from SAGE when you look at each of the individual methods. It's called Internet Data Collection, but it really focuses up on essentially using the internet as a means for surveying, although there are a couple of other little things in there. It's not bad, and it tends to be quite small and relatively cheap. Two that I think are quite good. The first one is Virtual Methods, Issues in Social Research on the Internet by Christine Hine. This is a newer book. It's a publication date of, I think it's like 2014 or 2015. So it's not a bad read. It really more looks at sort of more of the qualitative kinds of things. So if you were actually doing research online, so you look at like online interviewing, online observations, a lot of ethnography, anthropology kinds of things in here, using, you know, hyperlinking and social networking as a way of doing data analysis and data collection. So it's probably beyond the scope of what you would want to do with a CAS thesis, a six-year thesis. Probably the best one, I think, is this one here by Anderson and Kanuka, this e-research methods, strategies, and issues. This is a bit older. I don't know if there's a newer version out. This particular one, I think, is from 02 or 03. But it's a pretty good one. They look at both the use of the internet as for everything from the literature review to actually collecting data and analyzing data. So there's stuff in there about interviews and focus groups and surveys, and doing like online discussions, and also how to do analysis of a lot of that data. You know, because if you think about it, if you are doing your interview or your focus group through some sort of text-based medium, obviously you don't need to transcribe it. Similarly, if you're doing, say, like open-ended surveys through the computer, again, you don't need to transcribe them, whereas if you were doing them by paper, you would. Speaking of online surveys, looking at a couple of the method-specific ones, there is one here called Conducting Research Surveys via Email and the Web. It's written by these guys here. This one is quite good. It's very practical in nature. Does have a number of references in here to, you know, provide you with some advice. So if you're thinking about using like Google Forms or SurveyMonkey or Qualtrics or something, that might be a way to do that. Keep in mind that open-ended surveys are very similar to interviews in terms of the type of data that it will collect. So that might be something to keep in mind. Speaking of online interviews, there are a couple of ones here by Janet Salmons. One is Online Interviews in Real Time, and the other one is Cases in Online Interview Research. So this one here is more about the how-to. In fact, if you look at sort of the subtitle, it's guiding researchers through designing, planning, and conducting online interviews. Whereas this one is cases, so this is mostly examples of doing online interviews. And she looks at, in this one, doing online interviews through a synchronous medium like a video conferencing like Skype or Adobe Connect or those kinds of things, but also doing it in a text-based way, like doing a group interview in a discussion forum or doing individual interviews through email, and also in these 3D immersive environments. So if you're looking at some of the virtual worlds where you actually have an avatar that represents you, a lot of the gaming environments, for example, factor into this work as well. So there's a couple of different sort of general resources when you're looking at whether or not I want to do my data collection in more traditional format or maybe in a more electronic format. Regardless of how the format that you plan, you know, one of the things to keep in mind is make sure that the methods that you pick will generate data that will answer your research questions. And that's going to be the main thing that I'm going to be looking at when I'm looking at your table that you send me by the end of the day on Monday, is to see, can this question be answered by this kind of data? And so before I sign off on your methods, that'll be a conversation that you and I will have individually. And, from there, we'll start moving forward on finishing up that particular section of your methodology chapter, at least the initial draft of it. But again, remember that at the end of the day, and as you're looking through these, the one thing I would keep in mind above all else is whatever you select at the end of the day, you have to do. So you want to make sure it's something that is achievable for you to do, and you don't want to be over eager in terms of the amount of data that you collect, because you've got to manage that data. You know, you've got to transcribe a lot of it. You've got to analyze all of it that comes in. So you want to make sure that the amount of data and the nature of data that you're collecting is manageable.